Hello, this talk is called Breaking the Silence, Changing the Story, and it's about Buddhism and climate change. So to cut to the chase, I think the news on climate change isn't good. So what can we do as Buddhists, both in Buddhist Action Month 2016 and beyond in particular? Well, it might seem to be a dichotomy. Buddhism is quite a gradualist religion in a way. We work on ourselves, and then hopefully that kind of ripples out and changes society eventually. Whereas climate change is something that needs an urgent response. So there's been a lot of talk about tipping points and deadlines in the last 10 years in particular. But I think climate change is at heart a spiritual problem, needing spiritual answers. In particular, I think there's a lot of reason to think it's a very creative response to climate change to try and change the way we live. And I think in order to do that sustainably, we probably need to work on how we are as well, work on ourselves in order to change sustainably how we live. So I think that the Dharma has a lot to offer in that how do we change ourselves to live sustainably. And in fact, everything, traditional Dharma practice, mindfulness, meditation, simplicity of lifestyle, but also upholding spiritual values like love. So I think even within the absolutely traditional Buddhism, there's a lot of concern for alleviating suffering at all levels, physical, spiritual, psychological. But not just working on ourselves, but also working at collective level. So the Buddha, he talked to power. He didn't just talk to all the people he met on the streets and on the roads in India. He also talked to kings and their ministers. On one occasion, he mediated between two tribes about to go to war over water sources. He denied the caste system. So reading the Pali Canon, I think I get the impression that the Buddha was actually he's in dispute with people quite a lot of the time. He's arguing with people. And in fact, the Buddha was really quite a troublemaker. He was definitely not happy with just going along with business as usual. So I think it's very Buddhist to question how do we live collectively. And I think many Buddhists today are concerned about what you might call a greedy market fundamentalism, or also known as neoliberalism, which is kind of quite dominant in the world today. So just a very quick definition of that, neoliberalism. Basically, sort of greed is good. There's no such thing as society. Let the market decide pretty much everything, really, including social policy, effectively. So let the market decide. That will lead to economic prosperity. That will be good for everybody, and that's great. But trouble with this philosophy or approach is that it's not really... The wealth doesn't really trickle down. That's what's supposed to happen. But what in fact happens is the wealth trickles up from the people who are poor to the rich, and leads to greater inequality within society economically. But also, basically, it's bad for societies. This approach is bad for societies on almost every social indicator. Things like child mortality, average mental health, lots and lots of social issues are very badly affected, adversely affected by this neoliberal approach. So yes, the thing is, I think neoliberalism is presented as just human nature, or as a kind of monolithic reality, which that's just how things have to be. There's no other way that they can be. But I think in reality, in truth, it's actually a rationalisation of greed presented as a truth. So I think it's just one story. And I think there have been many, many stories and many ways of organising human beings that we've come up with in human history. Neoliberalism is just one story about human nature, of many stories that there have been. So, and also I think today it's not so cut and dried as to what is human nature, partly because we're in a new situation, I'd say. I think never before have we known our activities to be threatening the life support systems of the planet Earth, to the extent that we are doing. And I think never before have we known that we need to work together for collective survival in this situation. So I just said, I think it's very Buddhist to question how do we live collectively, but then how might we do that if we actually want to do that, if you agree with me? So personally, I'd recommend engaging with anything that you feel passionate about. I mean, for myself, I'm quite fond of fossil fuel divestment campaigns, so basically kind of lobbying organisations like pension funds or big organisations like universities to take away their investments from fossil fuel companies, so to divest their investments, take the money away from fossil fuel companies. But there's lots of issues which are all kind of linked, lots of social issues such as better treatment of refugees. Anti-neoliberalism has lots of aspects. There's things like the bees, neonicotinoid pesticides decimating bee populations, which conservative governments in the United Kingdom wants to allow, basically. There's resources for mental health patients, lots of issues. And also, I think I'd like to mention racism, actually, just as a factor, a very important factor in climate change and neoliberalism. The people on the sharp end of the effects of climate change are often people of colour, and often the poor. Basically, there's a very strong correlation between neoliberal policies, which are extremely bad for social well-being of countries, but also bad for doing anything real about climate change. So these issues are very linked. So often it's the poor in the world who've done the least, of course, to climate change, but who are suffering most from it, and are often people of colour. So anyway, to whatever extent is appropriate for you, we're all living very different lifestyles, got different passions and capacities. But also, I wouldn't neglect even the smallest things, even signing internet petitions. And I think it's also good to try and think strategically, as well as what you're passionate about, thinking about how to get the biggest effect for your action. Personally, well, just give myself as an example, I help out occasionally with a group called BP or not BP, that's British Petroleum. So basically, we think that British Petroleum, BP, gets a lot of social credibility through sponsoring organisations like the British Museum in London, the Royal Opera House, sort of big cultural institutions which are right at the heart of our society in the UK, in a way help part of how we define ourselves as a collective nation. So we want to try and end that sponsorship of those bigger institutions by BP. And certainly, I found it very inspiring working with BP or not BP, both because they're wonderful people. But I've also been, the more I've worked with BP or not BP, the more I've found out about the heroism of people around the world opposing BP, often heroically. For example, Colombian trade union activists are being or have been killed and imprisoned by paramilitaries in Colombia, because they're standing up for their own work, their workers' rights. Quite simple, moderate request, really. So the paramilitaries are working for the Colombian government, and the Colombian government's working with BP. So the trade union activists are being basically kind of cleared away for BP, and they're standing up to that, which I think is quite heroic. So, BP, its business plan includes climate change. It's basically almost 100% dedicated to extracting fossil fuels. So what it does is very problematic indeed from climate change point of view, but it also has an extremely bad record on, human rights, but also, and that's around the world, very, very consistent picture, but also on safety. There's a famous Deepwater Horizon oil rig explosion in the Gulf of Mexico in 2010, killed 11 people, but also a huge ecological disaster. And that's caused by simple recklessness at the highest levels in BP. So, okay, I mean, I've been campaigning with like a non-Buddhist campaigning group, BP or not BP, but also I'm keen on campaigning with Buddhists, So, for example, I worked with members of DANCE, that's the Dharma Action Network for Climate Engagement. And a couple of months ago, we went to the Wellcome Trust in London. And basically, we did a very simple process. We just sort of walked through an exhibition of Tibetan Buddhist artifacts actually at the Wellcome Trust headquarters, very slowly in single file, giving out leaflets. Then we stood outside, held up a banner. And basically, we're asking Wellcome Trust to divest its considerable investments from fossil fuel companies. And we did a sort of chant explaining what our position was, which was that Wellcome Trust does great stuff with funding research into medical conditions. And so it does very sort of philanthropic work, great stuff. But it funds this partly through quite large investments in fossil fuel companies. So it's a kind of incompatible position. They're doing something for good for human health, but then sort of funding climate change, you could say. So, I'm quite actually interested in trying to develop specifically Buddhist forms of peaceful protest. And that one did feel quite Buddhist to me. It felt like quite a devotional activity. We walked very slowly in single file up through this exhibition and chanted the Avalokiteshvara mantra as we went along. So I do appreciate that things are very complex. I use oil in my everyday life, but I think that doesn't mean I can't have an opinion about energy policy or about BP. And I think to take any position, to say anything, really, it means one has to simplify at least to some extent, and to that extent falsify. But if we don't draw a line, if we never draw a line, if we never oppose anything, then everything becomes allowed. So I think we do need to draw a line sometimes. Does it do any good? You might ask. Well, personally, I've got no doubt that history shows determined and sustained campaigning, not just one-offs, but sustained campaigning, can achieve seemingly impossible. There's lots of examples of this, such as votes for women in the UK and around the world, the civil rights movement in the USA in the 60s. They changed situations which seemed completely impossible to change at the time. Naomi Klein, in her very wonderful book, which I highly recommend, This Changes Everything, Capitalism Versus the Climate, she says, maybe we can't change human nature, maybe that's a bit of a tall order, but I'm sure we can change the stories we tell about ourselves. And I do believe that corporations fear the silence being broken. They want this, as I said earlier, they want this neoliberal approach, to which is so influential and dominant around the world. It dominates politics, dominates, but also through the media, it dominates what we think is possible. They want there to be a mindset where nothing can change. We just sort of give up. So I think corporations fear the silence being broken, and they fear dissent. So anyway, I mean, for me, this is a very personal statement I'm about to make. I know it's very different for other people. Different people feel differently and think differently from me on this. But for me personally, I just need to speak out, because if I don't, I feel like I'm colluding. So actually, when I speak out personally, I will do engage in peaceful protests, I feel more happy and authentic. I feel like I'm being myself. Okay, last point. I really recommend faith. I think we need to come from a place, if we want to look at these issues, we need to come from a very positive emotional state, as far as we can. And faith includes insight, but also includes metta. So yes, trying to see clearly, trying to see honestly with insight. And I think that's not just an ideal, I think it is actually a possibility that we can see with the eyes of Tara and Avalokiteshvara, for example. And that in fact we can engage in this protest, or in peaceful protest or campaigning, even just looking at these issues. We can engage with all this as a free offering of love from a state of abundance.